Eli was energy, idealism, just a force for good in this world.
One of the nicest, most decent human beings to ever walk this earth.
Eli was one of those rare people who just absorbed goodness wherever he went.
Always happy, always fun, had a constant twinkle in his eye.
Whatever you wanted to be in a non-fake way. It was really profound. You'd come to him with an idea, and he would both put the resources to trying to help figure out how you could make that happen, but also say, that's great, why don't you go do that? And so many times in life you're told, no, that's impossible, or here's the problems with it.
I think he was extraordinarily good at identifying people who were capable and then giving them strength and courage to be capable. Because sometimes in an environment of which you've got a lot of people coming at you or cutting you down or suggesting that you can't do the job, that you feel insecure about yourself or your abilities. And he was great at continuing to kind of reinforce that you could do anything that you wanted to do.
So when I think back to the interactions I had with Eli, what I'm struck by was his ability to be open-minded and open-hearted in every interaction that he had. So rather than sort of deciding what he thought somebody was like before he met them or got to know them, he would remain open and see the goodness in people and see the possibility in people and ideas. And it didn't really matter who you were, whether you were a world leader or whether you were an intern or whether you were a staff person.
He believed when he was going into a conversation with you, whoever you were, that he would learn something from it.
Eli engaged with everybody in this very direct, genuine, happy way. And it didn't matter your station in life, he was going to enjoy this relationship and get something out of the people and help them do better. And everyone looked at him to help themselves feel better about life, I think, and also because they enjoy being with him.
I saw him meet with people, all walks of life, from President Mandela to President Clinton, of course, to many others who were, some of the most recognized leaders in our world. And yet, the next day, he'd sit down with the interns for a brown bag lunch and have an incredibly stimulating and inspiring conversation about what the work that they were doing.
I don't know anybody who was a mentor to more people than Eli Segal. Or put another way, if you were to ask, folks, who is your mentor? You probably would have more people answer Eli Segal than just about anybody else in the world.
To me, he was a mentor and a coach and one of my very closest friends and somebody that I will think about every day of my life as I have, as somebody who I have looked up to and will continue to look up to as a role model and a real icon for me.
Eli was an optimist. He believed the best in people. He believed the best in life. He wanted, welfare to work is a good example of, taking a program that had such negative connotations of people who were living in poverty, who were dependent on the government, and saying, we're going to put them to work, we're going to give them jobs, we're going to make sure that they transition out of welfare and become productive.
He got so much joy out of watching people who he pulled together succeed and grow as individuals and professionally.
One of the women who was a mother who had gotten a job, and she was talking about what the program had meant to her, and she said, now that I have work, my children listen to me more and they respect me more and I feel better about myself. And I just remember that was Eli's takeaway from the day. It was a day of sort of celebrating a lot. He spoke and the president spoke and people had said really warm things to him. But that was the core thing for him, that he made this, helped this person help themselves in such a profound way.
Eli's passion, I think, was young people. And involving young people in, ultimately, in politics, in government.
He called me in 2004 when I was sitting on my back porch in Los Angeles and said, what are you doing to save, to help your country? And I said, nothing, I'm drinking a glass of wine. And he said, come to Little Rock in 4 days and work on the Clark campaign.
So he really looked at everybody as a rock star, if you will. And you felt that when you were with him. You felt that, you know, in every interaction that you had with him. He took us all very seriously, even when we were all very young and really had no idea what we were doing.
I mean, he had an extraordinary ability in a non-patronizing, non-threatening, completely supportive and completely helpful way of working with younger people and helping them to grow to their best potential.
And I remember being on a visit out in Denver, probably in the early 90s, where we were trying to get AmeriCorps off the ground in Colorado. And we were sharing a cab back from an event that was at the governor's mansion. And I'll never forget, Elena, he was telling me what, sort of some of his thoughts about the event. And then he stopped and he said, but what did you think?
He wasn't gonna, okay, I'm here, you go away now, kid. That wasn't his personality, which, by the way, is antithetical to what you often, in fact, unfortunately, most of the time, see in politics.
He was the chairman of two presidential campaigns. He ran a company. People in those positions don't always spend a lot of time worrying about how the young people in that organization are faring or even succeeding.
First, I wasn't sure he really wanted to hear it, and I started to share him thoughts. He said, and that's interesting. Tell me more about this. Tell me more about this. And what I realized from that conversation was something that really profound that has stuck with me, which is that young people have so much to give and so much to offer, and oftentimes they're not taken as seriously as they should be. Eli never made that mistake, and it's a mistake I've tried to never make in my career when I'm managing young people.
It made me realize that you can kind of go through your career never really paying attention to people who are younger, or you can go through your career paying a lot of attention, and I decided after I met Eli that I needed to pay a lot of attention to younger people. It's a virtue.
Being at the center of a presidential campaign, even one that's having trouble, it's fun. I mean, it's exhilarating, and so I don't want to paint Eli as, you know, this was this, you know, person who made great personal sacrifices for what he believed in. I mean, yes, he did, but I think he was having fun when he was doing it as well, and having fun and enjoying life and going through life with that smile on his face and twinkle in his eye was very, very much a part of Eli Segal.
My dad and I and Eli played a lot of golf, and Eli didn't believe that golf was scored correctly because he thought, you know, you could hit a great golf shot that landed in the water. Well, it's not your fault that the water was there. Or you could hit a great shot that should have been on the green, but it landed in the sand trap. It's not your fault. So he invented something called good shot golf, where you just got 1 point for every good shot you hit, and you were trying to get the highest score possible.
He was someone who had a tremendous capacity to see the humor in life and just enjoy it and enjoy himself.
Eli was coming down to Washington from New York for my dad's birthday, and he had been talking about these cannolis that he loved all this time, and my dad had never tried them. So Eli went to New York and bought, you know, a dozen cannolis and brought them on the train. But he was so excited about the cannolis that he ate most of them on the train on the way down to Washington.
Ooh, don't worry, be happy. Ain't got no place to lay your head.
He was a Pied Piper with children.
He took kids really seriously, both in terms of their what they had to offer as kids, their joy and their energy, and also in terms of what they thought about the world and what they cared about. really mattered to Eli.
And as a little kid, he would always ask me about my third grade teacher or the school play that I was in or the baseball team. And he wanted to know every little detail, who's the shortstop on my little league baseball team and what we were studying in class. But he was like that because he was passionate and because he cared.
So they could be the president of the United States and they could be kids. And he'd go to the kids.
Eli was, I mean, as a kid, Eli was just fun. He was the fun adult.
Like better, where we would talk about all the different people in my life, and it was, do you like your third grade teacher better or your second grade teacher better? You know, do you like Cal Ripken better or Rafael Palmeiro better? I mean, it just everything that I was interested in, he was therefore interested in, and it was a real interest.
All our wide friendship circles, children were there, and they were there not because their parents were upset, although God knows we were pretty beside ourselves. They were there because they were upset because of their relationship to him.
I was pregnant, trying to decide what I knew he was going to be a boy, and I was trying to decide what I was going to name him. And Phyllis was in town, and we had lunch, and I said, you know, I don't want to ask you if I could name him Eli because I don't want to make it a burden that you feel. You know, I didn't want it to be naming him after in some way that she felt responsible. But I want to tell you that I want to name him Eli, and I want you to know why, because it's going to make me emotional. You want to name your child after somebody that you think they can exemplify and grow up to be like, and I couldn't think of somebody who I would more wish my child to be like as a man. Let's dance instead, let's dance for a while. Heaven can wait, we're only watching the skies. Hoping for the best, but expecting the worst. Are you gonna drop the bomb or not? Let us die young, or let us live.